Hi everyone, how are you guys? So I'm actually not going to be performing later because I'm performing tomorrow at Rockwood. I'm hoping that you guys will come there to see me perform there. So I'm gonna do a little bit of a longer kind of presentation thing and tell you guys a little bit about who I am and what I've done and where I've come from, because that's kind of my thing. I just like to show people the journey and then talk about where I'm at, and kind of hopefully you guys will learn something through that, as well as my Ableton set. Because I've realized a lot of people might not know who I am, right? A lot of people, who knows who I am? Okay, like five people. Okay, awesome. So I'm going down the right road here with this presentation here. So I'm Laura Escudé, AKA Alluxe. You guys can follow me on the web, and I would surely appreciate a shout out if you guys like what you see and hear tonight. I'm a music producer, I'm a controllerist, and I'm a live show designer. So I actually wear about 20 million different hats, but someone told me one time that I should narrow it down to three things. And so those are the things that I narrowed it down to, but I do a lot of different things as well. I'm a violinist. I started out in the classical music world, and I started doing electronics with violin in 2000. After going to my first rave, my boyfriend's or best friend's boyfriend was a DJ, and he said, come to this rave. And for a year, I was like, no, I don't want to go to the rave. Like, what? I don't go to raves? And then I went to the rave, and I fell in love with electronic music. So I started trying to play violin over drum and bass music, and it was terrible. It was awful. But, you know, I started, you know, to wonder what was going on behind the scenes there. And in 2005, I ended up working at M Audio in Los Angeles. Fast forward, I started learning how to produce, and I got super into technology. I had this broken piece of gear. I saw this guy at this rave, and I said, you're the guy on the other end of the tech support line that I've been talking to, right? And my shit's totally fucked up. And he's like, do you want a job? And I was like, yeah, sure do. So I started working at M Audio in tech support, where all these people were calling us and emailing us and yelling at us, and they were very mad. And there was this program people were calling about called Ableton. And I was like, I don't know what this Ableton program is, but they said, you know, do you know how to use this? And I said, sure do. Yep, I sure do. So I learned how to use Ableton Live and started performing. This is in 2005, performing with my PlayStation MIDI glove and Ableton Live. And then in 2007, I started working at Ableton. I was actually Ableton's first West Coast product specialist. So I went around and did all the demos at Guitar Center and Sam Ash. And at the time, people were like, man, Pro Tools is industry standard. I don't know about this Ableton Live program. I was like, you'll see. You'll just wait and see. So this is me at the NAMM show in 2008. Welcome to Ableton. Can I take your order, please? I had a super cool blazer and headset combo. I thought it was awesome. And, you know, I heard a lot of this, like, man, but Pro Tools is the industry standard. Like, Ableton Live, that's just like that free program that comes in all of the M Audio stuff. And I was like, no, you guys don't understand. Like, one day it's going to be huge. It's going to be amazing. But still, Ableton was getting dissed. Then I became a certified trainer in 2008, which was awesome. And at that time, it didn't mean anything because what was a certified trainer? No one even really cared about Ableton Live except for us small groups of super nerdy people. So I just started, you know, hey, I've got this title now. Cool beans. But then Cirque du Soleil called me. And I ended up moving to Vegas and programming their Viva Elvis show. And then Kanye West called me, and I ended up going on tour with him for the last 6 years, between 2011 to 2017, or 2016. I did the Yeezus tour. This is me with my rig on tour. You can notice that there's about five different computers. Some of them aren't in the picture, but five different computers from the tour, on the tour. And I worked with Jay-Z. I did the Watch the Throne tour. And I worked with Drake, and I worked with the Yeah Yeahs, and The Weeknd, and Herbie Hancock, and Bon Iver. And so I worked with all these different people designing their Ableton Live shows and their programming their live shows and doing more creative stuff. Like with Herbie, I gave him my setup and I said, hey, this is what I do. And so we adapted his setup with my setup to be his setup, which was really cool. And so I decided to form my own company called Electronic Creatives. So now I have my own team of nerds, except for they're a lot cooler than that. They're all artists and controllerists, and we're all out there in the world of pop music and hip hop music and, you know, all out there as our day jobs. And then we're all artists as our other jobs. Basically, I never sleep and I don't have any time to myself, but we're all doing things. So now you're kind of wondering, like, what exactly does she do, right? So here are some of the things that I do. I produce as Alluxe, which is my artist name. I do collabs and production for other artists. I just put out an EP, collabed with Sister Crayon and this guy, Mr. Motherfucking Esquire, who's from New York. Do you guys know him? Anyone? Couple people? Okay, cool. And I perform. I do live stuff. That's my electric violin. And I do presentations and talks like I'm doing here. I was just at Berkeley in Valencia, Spain, and did a residency there a few months ago. And I do composition for companies, short films, sound design, licensing, live violin, just played on the Big Grams album, programming and live show design. So I did Porter Robinson's live show, just did the St. Pablo tour, and then tour DJing. So a big part of my mission is to move from the programmer world, which is known as Pro Tools. People still call my job on tour Pro Tools, right? I'm like, I guess it's like Kleenex, like everyone calls any kind of napkin Kleenex, right? So I literally would get these laminates that say Pro Tools on it. I'm like, but it's not Pro Tools, that's like not even the job. It's Ableton Live is the software, and the job is music programmer. So I've been trying to move past that and show the touring world that programmers can be controllerists, right, with using all of these controllers. So I've pushed into that world a little bit. You can see me DJing for Kaiza here. I snuck my ohm into the Iggy Azalea shows. No one even knew what was going on here, right? They're just like, oh, there's something on stage. It's like, I'm doing controllerism in a big pop show. This is awesome. I performed with Charlie XCX. I toured with Miguel. I was in his band, and I also DJed, opened up his show, because I said, hey man, you know, you need some music, like, before you go on. He's like, okay, what do you have in mind? I'm like, me DJing? He was like, cool. So I got to do my thing and do my controllerism thing, and it was really awesome. And I got to DJ for Snoop Dogg and Kendrick, and Kendrick's people showed up with a USB stick right in the middle of the show and said, here, can you play these songs? I was like, man, I hate this part. When you gotta drag songs into the session while the session's playing, that's why I get paid the big bucks. So there's me performing. I also do musical direction. I'm a band leader. Put together the Iggy Azalea band thing, Becky G, and then I also got my company here. So Electronic Creatives is my squad. We do gear rental, technology design, those are my peeps. And we do a lot of auto-tune for a lot of artists out there that I can't talk about because I'm live streaming right now. And I can't talk about anyway. So, but there's auto-tune in the background of a lot of pop shows. We'll just leave it at that. So they come to my company and we say, sure, we'll make it sound like your artist is completely in key. Yeah, and no one will be able to know. And here's the rig and it's all running through Ableton Live and, you know, that's what we do. So basically we provide solutions for artists out there and we are artists ourselves. So I'm going to talk a little bit about, that was like the super abridged version of my whole like life story, by the way, because like when I go to places, like I'm going to Berklee School of Music after this, and you know, when I do that, I kind of talk for a really long time, so I feel like I'm like fast forwarding through like my whole career. But I'm going to just talk a little bit about the design process of a live show and then show you guys what I've got going on up here, because some of you are like, I don't really care like who you are. I just want to know what's going on with Ableton Live. So basically with a live show, the first things I look at are stems, music editing, transitions. So on a tour such as one of these pop or hip hop tours, we're responsible for taking the stems, working with the musical director, editing the songs together, remixing the songs, making transitions, making sure that certain sounds come out of different specific outputs, making sure the drummer, whoever has a click that they want, making sure there's count-ins for the band, all kinds of things. Basically, you just have to work with every different artist and figure out what it is that they want to have in their in-ears on stage, which can be challenging, especially when you're working with people that like to change their minds as you're walking to the stage and the house lights are going down and you're editing on your laptop on your knee during the middle of the show and then putting files on the B computer and moving them over to the A computer like in the middle of the show. That was basically my life for 6 years. So stems, music editing, transitions, like if someone's like, man, I want that indigenous lion roar from wherever the fuck. You got to go find that indigenous lion roar and put it in the session, and like then they're like, we want it to pan, and then you're like, okay, and then you make it pan, and then you're like, but then I want to change the key of this song, and then you're like, oh, okay, and then you change the key, no, but I want to go back to the version that we did yesterday, and you're just like, oh, okay. So you got to have like all of these different versions and like basically be on super on point and figure out like what you're doing, and you know, and be one step ahead of the artist, because a lot of the artists that I work with, like, they don't even know what they want, right? So you have to like translate and like be in their head and be like one step ahead, like, I think they're gonna want to do this, so I'm gonna have this on deck, and then I'm gonna have this on deck, and then just have like 10 different versions of things on deck, and then when you get to them, be like, okay, do you want to do any of these? And then they're like, nah, and you're like, okay. Or if you're good, which most of the time I've gotten really good at mind reading, then they're like, okay, I want this version, but then we'll, you know, we'll do this version and this version. So anyway, it's a whole lot of work. It's very rewarding. It's a lot of fun. It's very stressful as well. But I've met a lot of good people and had a lot of good times and done a lot of crazy, crazy shit. So there's also the band and instruments, like working with the people in the band to make sure, like, as Johnny was talking about earlier, taking out different parts, like if there's a drummer, or if there's like a sax player or whatever, taking all that those parts out, or like background vocals, keeping the, you know, certain lead vocals in for certain artists that, you know, need to have their lead vocals in at certain parts of the songs, because not everyone is Adele and can sing live. And so there's all different kinds of stuff. So there's also the controllerism aspect of live shows, which I've been pushing forward. So as you saw earlier, me inserting controllers into these shows so that we can control things the way that we want to control them. So that is part of my mission, is to bring more controllerism to these big shows. Also the vocals, like I was just mentioning, background vocals, you know, layering stuff, layering live sounds, live vocals, which are like pre-recorded live vocals with like a shitty mic so that it sounds like it's live, with like the BGVs from the original track, like done in different ways, and then like pulling some of those out if there's like certain people on stage and then other people aren't on stage. So there's all kinds of effects and sounds, like, you know, I think it, you know, Drake's Coachella show every year was like the same like bomb at the end of every, so it's like, you know, whatever, or like the air horn sound, or like, you know, people who are just like trying to get creative with effects and sounds, so like putting all that stuff in the sessions and like, and trying to actually get away from all that stuff, because like, you know, for those of us that are producers, we're like, okay, that's VEC 013 or whatever, you know? So we can kind of tell what that sound is, like layering them maybe, or like putting the lion sound and putting some like distortion on it and then putting like the bomb over it or whatever. So effects and sounds, the band cues and the clicks. So like, you know, the band will be like, hear something like chorus 2, 3, 4 in their ears. Or like a countdown or whatever they want to hear, or like the artist will hear like a triad when like the chorus is coming up, or like, you know, just specific things like that. So there's all kinds of just like cues and crazy stuff going on, or like something's about to move. There's going to be pyro. Everyone get away from where the pyro is going to be. Like, don't get burned. All that kind of shit, right? So like lighting, basically, you know, using time code, using MIDI to control lighting on stage in some of these big shows. And then I actually have my own lighting rig that I roll around with now, which I sadly couldn't bring with me because it was too heavy. And then video, so turning the whole show into a story, so syncing with the visuals on stage. I also have my own little audio-visual show that I'm building right now with Resolume. Is anyone using Resolume for their, yeah, a couple people? So that's the wave. There's other apps too, but Resolume is kind of like most like Ableton Live. Okay, so this next part is like actually for my other people, because it's like a whole other thing about like, yeah, you can do it, which you guys don't need that speech because you guys are all here. So I'm going to talk to you. I'm going to actually just perform a little bit and show you a bit about my session here. So I'm going to go down here and then, oh, ah, that's not cool. I know. Boo! Because I just was doing this earlier and it wasn't making that sound. Okay, latency or recording? What do you guys think? You guys don't care because you're here. Yeah. So you don't want to watch it later. But then there's all these other people that like to watch it later. Shit, what should we do?
Well, click on the recording, right?
I guess I'll turn the recording off. I can do this another time. But that's so sad.
How about we try latency first? Because we can always
I can't make it any. It's already at 128. I would like basically kill myself if it was anything. So shit. Okay. All right. Stop recording. Bummer. Okay. There I am. There's screen flow. Damn it. Okay. So screen flow. See, I was like trying to do it all covertly in the background so you guys wouldn't even know that I was doing it. Now my cover is busted. Shit. Okay. Now let's see. Here we go. So this is the part where if you guys come to my show at Rockwood tomorrow, you'll hear like some sub bass. But so if you guys see me like kind of like tapping on here and it sounds not as bassy, you'll know why. Okay, so I am going to do a little demo and grab my violin. I guess I could turn it up, right? Oh, I just inadvertently started recording. Let's see. Is that cool?
Yeah.
Okay, it's like up all the way. So first things first, just to make sure, I got that. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, guys. So if you want to see more where that came from, come to Rockwood tomorrow night.
What time?
7 o'clock. 7 to 7:45. I know it's like people are just getting off of work and stuff like that, but stage two. Yeah, so I'm going to actually attempt to actually do this one more time. So let's see what happens. Okay, so that was a little snippet what I do. And now I'm going to show you guys kind of all these like thingamabobs and stuff that I have going on up here. So I have my push. Never mind those crackling sounds, just like whatever. Yeah. Because I'm just in case you guys forgot who I am. I took the air horn out of my set like last week because I figured, you know, it was just like kind of overplayed. It was just like, you know, I was like hearing the air horn a lot. Actually, no, it was like a couple months ago. No, it was like, okay, never mind. I've got like all these different like one shots. That's like my favorite one. Never mind, that's crackling sound. Actually, you know what? I am gonna raise the buffer size now because I don't care because I'm not performing. Because like 256 on the violin, and usually I do vocals too, but I need like a mic stand and stuff like that. So, but yeah, like when you're like. And it's like, yeah, it's like not cool. So 120 is kind of like the lowest, as low as I'll go. So I've got these things here. And then over here, got this like sub. It's still doing that. Screen flow is another fucking beast. And then at a certain point in the song, I actually have it going to, yeah, at Alluxe Music on the gram. So, oh, there we go. Okay, whatever. So, got this like. Favorite thing, synth sound there. So I have it like kind of going in between like the sub bass thing. And then like the synth thing, which is the, anyway, I could just like do that all day. I just have like some dummy clips here that are changing like the sounds for me, like as I go down the scenes. And in this particular song, like sometimes I'll hit the next scene with this foot controller. So this is the POC, X Tempo Designs POC. It's a wireless foot controller. It basically is just like having a keyboard, but for your foot. It's wireless. And I've worked a lot with this company, and Trevor from this company has like been super supportive of me. And I actually was like rocking this thing like 7 or 8 years ago. Because I like to date myself when I'm talking up here. So 7 or 8 years ago, I'm not old or anything. But anyway, I was using this, and then he started making a Bluetooth version, and I'm the first person to have the Bluetooth version. Yeah. I just got it. So I'm very, very excited about it. So I use this to advance some of the scenes when I'm like playing violin and have my hands busy. And then I also use this to control the different loopers here. So. So I've got four different loopers. This guy controls the looping and like the undoing and like the clearing of the loops and then like bringing it back like at the end when I brought back what I had recorded earlier. Bring it back with the foot controller. And then I've also got this other Bluetooth foot controller, which is really rad. And this is the iRig Blueboard. It's amazing, both very portable. So this one, I kind of like have this like octaver thing, and then I actually forgot to use that in the song. But that's why I'm rehearsing today, because I'm at Requiem tomorrow. So there's I have this octaver thing on. Like this one is just like regular, and then just like and then when I feel like I want to be rude, and then when I feel like I want to be like super dark, and then I'm like boring classical. So that's what this guy does. And then I've got my Wii controller doing different things. So just like a bunch of different effects on this thing. I've used this for years. I use this for Kanye's vocal effects in his live show, like auto-tune, delay, you know, all that kind of stuff. So the Wii controller, who knew? 7 years. You heard it here first. No. Okay, so the Wii, which I love. I used to actually be controlling stutter edit with it, but then when I upgraded to Sierra, stutter edit didn't work anymore, and it hasn't been updated since 2014. I love, does anyone else have that problem? Does anyone else use stutter edit? You do? Dan, what's the deal?
I don't know. I haven't upgraded. That's like another reason I want.
I know. Well, the only reason I upgraded is because there is this nebulous sound quality problem between like 10.8 and 10.11 that everyone was like, it's OS X. And you're like, motherfuckers. And then we just like get these weird glitchy things like every couple of months or something. So then I finally like upgraded to Sierra, and now like half my shit doesn't work. But I think it fixed the like little glitchy problems, but so anyway, I used to stutter it sounded way cooler, but I got some other glitchy stuff on here right now. And then I've got this guy, my own. And when I'm at home, or like when I have my regular rig, I have this ohm that lights up. It's like my custom, it's like my baby. It was in the very beginning of this. Yeah, that's my baby. But this one is like, it's smaller and more functional for traveling. So I control, you know, the different parts of my songs here. All the violin stuff is over here. Okay, so all the violin stuff is over here. This is like a beat repeat. I think that's probably fade to gray, because like, it's fade to gray. And then I've got like the, like, pitch shifting. And like the end of my songs, I do like some weird shit here. This. And then like these are like the different looping channels. Pay no mind what's going on right now. And so this is like the main one, and then this is like the bass one with like that octave thing. And then this is the delay thingy, and this is like the distortion thingy. So I can mix all of these different loops here, right? And then like, okay, so I'm just like gonna clear the violin there because I'm tired of hearing it, but the, like all these buttons also control the loop, and then I have them doubled as key stuff on the foot. Same kind of thing. Easier to do with two hands. And then like a filter thingy. And then these are like overall effects down here. Fade to gray, because like you never know when you're gonna fuck up, right? You just gotta have that fade to gray on deck, right? If you don't have fade to gray, you're not taking any risks in your set. This is like my rave, what do I call this? Oh, my rave, like sidechain. Never mind that sound. Oh yeah, there we go. Why? Oh, here we go. There we go. So I got this beat. I'm glad I caught that. I'm gonna save this, biatch. Okay. So this is like the, like my weird rave kind of effect thingy. Let me go to like a different line. Gotta have some like sidechain ravey shit. Violin. And then over here, got the Alluxe button, and then these guys control the effects on the push. I didn't advance to the next scene. It's like doing random weird shit that is fun to do. And then what else? Oh yeah, I got this vocal thing. Check, check, hello, hey, hey, hey. And then I've got this crazy little vocal thing that I sometimes do. And I suck like a looper. That was it. Okay, done. There's a ghost in the machine. I don't know what just happened. Oh, I think I just accidentally brought. Oh, I just stepped on the foot control. See, that's the thing. You gotta watch where you're stepping. All right. Questions? Yes.
So those master effects that you had, are those? How are you routing them? Are they all on a return track, or is it
like the master ones are just on the master. I mean, I have everything going at the master, and then, you know, I'm not like super fancy yet. Like, I would like to be like rolling around with my own like front of house and monitor person yet, and so when that day happens, then I'll have like specific outs, and I'll be like, don't turn the violin up too loud, and like, you know, all this stuff. But for now, I'm mixing everything on my own because I don't trust anyone to not like make the violin sound insanely loud on top of the beats. And also, I'm not like cool enough yet to have a front of house engineer. But when I do, then I'm gonna send everything out separate outputs and then have them mix that stuff separately, which is gonna be a glorious day. So on the master, I've got what I call fake faders, which are just like, you know, when you're using something that uses a script, but then you don't want like this, if you don't have this fader mapped to like the right thing, you want it to accidentally like push up something to plus 6 dB, right? Accidentally in the middle of your set, because like it likes to do that sometimes if you don't map it. So I just like map everything to like fake faders, as they're called, which are like these macros here. So it's just like mapping it to nothing. essentially. And then I've got like my Effetrix, which is I think the Wii shit. Like my DJ effects rag, just like shout out Ben Hovey for his Hoveycraft channel, which I use, his beat repeat. Then just like a bunch of my rave effects, like, you know, just all kinds of shit, basically. And then I just like try different things out, essentially, and then see what happens. So I got all that, but then on the tracks themselves, if I want to just like put effects on the tracks, then I just use, I have the effects like right on the tracks themselves. And I used to do like the A, B, and like, you know, like mix my tracks and all that kind of stuff, and then have like different effects for like different, you know, sides or like sides of the deck or whatever you want to call it. But then I was like, you know what, I'm not a DJ. Why am I trying to mix my own tracks? Because then people be like, oh, that was a good DJ set. Like, oh no, but that was all my music. So now I stop and I'm like, yeah, so give it up, you know? So I just like, it's just all, I mean, it's kind of staggered, but depending, you know, but in general, I just kind of like stop between songs now, unless I do like, sometimes I'll do like little segues with like looping the violin and I'll just like kind of segue into another song, but then, you know, so, and then on the vocals, I've got like their own effect. I mean, everything's just got their own effects on the specific channel, basically. Hopefully that answers your question. Yes.
So, one of the most powerful things with Ableton is the fact that you can assign different quantization levels.
Quantization.
All the different settings and individual clips and stuff. And so I'm curious, actually, because I have a little bit of background, but I'm curious where you have different levels of quantization in that set.
I have usually just keep it on one bar, just because like that's what I'm used to, and. That's why I got the foot controller to have the button so that I can hit the next scene if all else fails, if my hands are busy. Like, I'll try to go here, you know, for the most part, but then if my hands are busy, then I'll come down to the foot controller. But I generally keep it all in one, otherwise I'll just, like, get fucking confused. And then I'll just, like, hit something and be like, why isn't it coming in? And then it'll come in later, like, or it'll come in too fast, or just, you know, I don't know. I'm a fan of like trying new things, but I also just like, I'm a creature of habit, so I just keep it all at one personally. Now, other people's shows, I have it at none usually, because they're like, play this next song right now. And you're like, okay. And then if you gotta wait a bar, they're like, where the fuck is the song? So yeah, but for my own stuff, the bar, yeah. Can we talk about how we know each other? We were on tour together. I actually have two tour buddies here tonight with me. Yeah, you. Tom and I toured together on basically every Kanye tour for the last 6 years. He did the back line, and he was just like the backbone of the whole show. And then Brandon, well, I don't even know what your show was. He came into...
The reason was that goddamn puppet, but there became...
Yeah, so he was there on Yeezus, and so, yeah, it's awesome to see you guys here. What other questions? Yes?
What would you recommend for a smooth performance with no crashes with Ableton? I mean, not the software itself, but sometimes you get that in a big session, you get the sound deteriorating. I mean, the sound go bad or something like that on my computer.
What sound card are you using?
RME.
Oh.
Fireface US.
Oh. Well, I got nothing for you then.
Yeah,
stop downloading all that crazy shit on your computer.
Yeah,
you
that.
Know.
Yeah,
I don't know.
Drive in it.
Also, are you on version
has the new high speed PCI
PCI SSDs in them. Mm-hmm. They're like 3 times, 4 times faster than the other SSD drives.
I did change it. So. I do have a new drive SSD, but I don't know. It's just the live performance that I'm having a problem with right now, where the sound just crashes in the middle of the.
It crashes or it glitches or it
glitches.
Skips.
Yeah, it's a glitch.
Does it skip a beat or does it glitch?
No, the whole sound thing just goes. It just collapses. Not the software, just the sound part.
Software. What OS are you on?
It's a new one.
Have you monitored your performance? Like, are you slamming against 100?
Like, yeah, something like that. The kicks would. Yeah, that's definitely got to do it too.
Yeah. Well, oh, actually, video card too. Sometimes, like, a really new machine, but with, like, Intel integrated graphics, will kill you. Like, the video pulling that processing load off of the CPU really frees a lot up.
It was that at some point, and it did take it back to Apple. They did install a new motherboard for me with a new graphic. Yeah, it was an issue. And they gave me a new graphic card. Actually, they gave me, like, a new board, a motherboard, the whole thing.
Oh, is this the 2011 model?
That's the one.
Yeah, I had that, still have that model, and they replaced them, and it's just, that model is just a piece of shit. Yeah. Yeah, just like get a new one. And the fact that you're on that and you're on Sierra, like, makes me doubly, like, scared.
All right. Well, in general, like, for live performance, to have a smooth performance, what would you recommend?
God, get a PC. No.
Reasonably newer computer. I mean, Apple considers any computer over 5 years vintage. They no longer even keep parts for them.
Okay, yeah.
So a 6-year-old computer by Apple is considered antique.
Not even old. And like you can update it to Sierra, but that doesn't mean you should.
Yeah. So I would consider a newer computer. I would definitely make sure that when you're in your rehearsals before you get on stage, that you're not using more than 50% of your CPU. If you're performing in your rehearsals and you notice your CPU meter's way up at 80 or 90%, it's only going to get worse when you go do something live and you're in a weird environment and the temperature's changed and there's a huge subwoofer rattling your computer while it performs. So you want to plan ahead and make sure that you're not using too much of your computer power to begin with.
Okay.
And if you find that your performance really involves all these soft synths that are using a ton of CPU, find lighter ones. You know, like I said earlier, I have React consoles. 90% of my computer's power for that one synth sound. And damn, it's a good synth sound, but it's too expensive CPU-wise, so I'll resample it and use a sample of the sound and a simpler, and then suddenly my 90% of my CPU goes down to 4%. So.
Yeah, I've gotten like a ton of work resampling shit for people, you know? So just like, yeah, I've got all this stuff, how do I play it live? I'm like, you don't. You resample it. I'm like, does anyone use auto sampler anymore? It's like something else now, right? But like the Redmatica stuff, that was like gold. I still have like a copy of that. And I was like, and it has like do not delete on it. Apple bought it and then nothing happened with it. Yeah. But yeah, I actually have it, so, you know, just hit me up or whatever. But auto sampler. Good stuff. It'll just like go through and it'll be like velocity 1, velocity 2, velocity 3, like over all the keyboard, and then it'll make a EXS file which you can then convert into a sampler file.
I think there's a Max for Live device as well.
There's probably is.
Automatically do the same thing.
Yeah, there's probably like a newer version of that, basically.
Yeah, there's actually auto sampler in main stage, like the $29.
Oh, is that what they did with it?
Yeah, apparently.
Oh, main stage, though.
Yeah, I know. It's
Yes.
Can you show us what's in your group tracks, the fourth one?
Sure. This is very personal, so. Not sure if I'm ready. Okay, so I've got, like, different songs have, like, different stems. And then like different versions, alt versions of the songs. Some songs, kind of like Johnny was saying, you know, are just playing them all the way through. It's a song, you know. And then other songs, like the one I played for you guys, is like I try to get, you know, a little more improvisational with it, but it still somewhat has a structure. So when I do songs like that, you know, there's like this like whole group here, which is like the song, got the drop. got the crazy synth. And then, you know, there's just like a bunch of other, you know, bunch of other stuff around. But yeah, a lot of them are two tracks because I'm playing a lot of violin and I've like mixed it in such a way, or, you know, I'm just playing on top of it. And then, you know, over here I've got like the ability to do the push, like drum loop stuff. And then over here, this is like the sub bass synth. And then like this one is for my rolly when I like can bring or have more of my gear. I have my rolly and I like do crazy stuff on it. But yeah, so it's the tracks, and then these are alt versions. These are like the different violin tracks. We've got some like just like weird shit going on. It's delays and distortion and the input.
On the other track.
Huh? What? This thing? I don't know. This is like that guy, the violin dude that just put something out on the Ableton site. What's his name? Trainer? Something? I don't know. He just like, he came out, they had an article about him like a few weeks ago. I think he's from Brooklyn. I don't know. It was like one of his things.
It's a Max device?
It's a Max. Yeah, it, here, I'll just, I'm still fucking with it. It does like weird shit. It's called Five Finger Discount. Can't remember his name. I feel bad. I should give him credit. But wiresundertension.com, I guess. RTFM at wiresundertension.com. But it's free, yeah. This one is like the... and then I put like the... This is like my sub bass vibes. I feel like super hard when I play that live. And then... Delay, and then I've also got this like crystallizer thing. It's like got some like reverse delay thing that I turn on sometimes. And then my distortion. And then, oh, my favorite shit, which I didn't even.
Can I ask you a question before you move on?
Yeah.
So, like, I'm just wondering, like, why you have different tracks for each one of your kind of group effects versus, like, just grouping them in the same track. You know what I mean? Like, where you can take, like, that whole chain and make it...
Because I'll do, like, different sends and, like, you know, I just, like, want to have, like, more control over it. But, like, all the violin stuff is coming in here. Mm-hmm. And then I've got, like, different loopers... on different tracks here.
How are you selecting those?
So through the this guy here, this changes. Yeah, see?
I see.
Right, and then this is the delay thing, and then this is the distortion thing, and then...
So you can have multiple different loops without stopping them?
Yeah, with different sounds on each loop, and then here, you know, I've got the, like, clear it, you know, record, all that kind of stuff. It's basically the same for every lane here. And then some, you know, I have, like, multiple loopers for, like, I started doing this cover of, like, Don't Laugh, but Selena Gomez, and you'll see it if you come to Rockwood tomorrow. And yeah, there's like, I have like an automatic kind of like looper thing happening when I go to that. So over here, I've got like what I call like loop dummies, where if I have a loop going on, I send MIDI out of the IAC bus back into Ableton to like kill anything that's going on the loopers, which might sound a little crazy, but it basically is just like triggering a MIDI message that then sends information to kill any loops that are going on in the session. So like I can be like looping violin, vocals, whatever, go to the next song, and then like, bam, nothing. So I've got that going on. And then in that song that I just did, I have like one part where I kill the vocals, which I wasn't doing vocals, but, and then it stops the violin, but it doesn't delete, like clear the violin, because then I bring the violin back at the end. So there's like that message. And then over here, like this is the same old love one. And so these messages basically send to different loopers. So like when I, like I'm playing violin throughout the whole song, so I'm like looping, 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 I'll like go down, you know. Oh, I turn it off. But I'll just like go down with the foot controller, and then it'll kind of like at a certain point, it'll like trigger this loop to come in, and then I'll like do the bass line or whatever. That is probably like, would be like a whole other thing, but basically they're routed out of the IAC driver, okay, off out of three and channel 3 and 11 and coming back into Ableton. So yeah, so we've got that stuff. I also got this rad thing called MIDI Merlin, which my friend, who I used to work at M-Audio with, he's like the sickest thereminist. He's like so sick. And he also just like went down this like whole rabbit hole of like audio to MIDI in real time. And it is kind of awesome. Like it's almost like all the way there. So I'll see if, huh?
Articulation.
Yeah, articulation's kind of like me, but let's see. Let's see if I can get this going. So I've been attempting to import this into Ableton with this program called Loopback, and it works 50% of the time. So I didn't do it today, but I'm going to try to just, excuse me. Yeah, it's, you know, freaking out, but let me, oh, we're already up to, it's good, like a lot of those are good, but then like the stuff that's not good is like kind of not good. So so you can't really like rock out on it, but then you can just be like, anyway, so there's that. And then I kind of, sometimes it works, and I have that coming into Ableton through Loopback, which was like the sound flower-ish replacement. And then this thing can like allows me to change the looper stuff with key mapping. And then this is my friend's MIDI lights thing. So like when I perform in LA or somewhere where there's a budget to fly out my stuff, my MIDI stuff, this app controls wireless lights around me. And this is the app. My friend Henry Strange made it. And so yeah, so I've got like, yeah, different lights and stuff that happen that are very basic, but lights are cool. They look cool. And then over here, this is like an interesting scenario, and actually maybe like someone has a solution that's better than what I've been doing. But so when I perform, I like to record my performance, but I like to record all of the tracks separately, because then I like to go in after the facts and mix it, you know? So like if like during my performance, like I fucked up on the violin or something happened, then I can like go back in and fix it. And so I like to record like the vocals dry, the vocals wet, the violin dry, the violin wet, the tracks, like all this stuff separately. But then I started making beats with Push and wanting to be improvisational in the session view that way. So before I would used to just like click the global record button and it would like just record in the session view and then I'd be done and then I'd mix it all up and like have my video or whatever and put it together and it would sound like I'd be able to have it sound however I wanted. But then when I started doing the Push thing, it won't let you record in the session view and also in the arrangement view. So then I was like, well, how do I still capture like what I'm doing with the Push, but then record it onto the session view? And someone told me about this Max for Live app where you put it on every channel and like you tell it where to record to. And I tried that and it did not work for me. It was just like a hog. So then I started recording the scenes like and then turning off the scenes. So I have like everything routed to these scenes here. And then what I'll do is like, this is so crazy. But if anyone has any better way to do that, I'm like, just would love you. So I'll turn on, start recording on scene launch, and I'll turn it on, and I'll start my session, and then I'll actually like delete all the stop buttons underneath it. So like I'll start recording, right? And then, you know, come over here and do my thing or whatever, and it won't usually glitch like that. And then I'll turn this off, and then I'll just like continue to go down the scenes. And then like at the end of my set, I basically just take all of those clips and then like that's all of my rerouted stuff. Are you guys following me here? This is like so crazy, I know. But it works. And then I get to have like all of like the improvisational looping stuff on the Push and everything else. And it's all recorded separately. So that's what that's for. It's kind of wild. And I, of course, do all the resampling and all that stuff. And then over here, this is when I get really fancy. Like when I had my EP release, I had a lighting guy and a video guy. And that was amazing because I was just like, yes, like I've made it. Didn't have front of house, but I had a lighting guy and a video guy. And I was sending them like MIDI information and it was like triggering their rigs. So, you know, I just keep those there and like deactivated, like just, you know, and I look at them every once in a while and I'm like, the next time I'm gonna have a lighting and video guy and a front house person. But yeah, so that's what that is for over here, sending info. And then I think that's it. And then I've got like this like reverb and like simple, you know, delay, whatever on here. And man, I've talked for a long fucking time. Wow. Okay, so are there any other questions? Yes.
I was wondering if you, like, when you, I always find in Ableton, like, the way that you lay them vertically down, lay out your tracks, that's the way I always tend to play the tracks. Do you ever switch up the order for different shows or play them in reverse order or do anything like that, or you just usually do the same list?
I mean, no, I change the set list all the time. But that's like one of the beauties of using, you know, because I can just be like, yeah, I don't know, I just feel like doing you down here or whatever. And like a lot of the live shows that I've built for big artists, we do that same thing because they'll be like changing the set list like right before the show. So, yeah. Basically.
Do you ever just do it on the fly, decide like I'm going to play that song, I'll play it later?
Yeah, sometimes. Yeah. I don't know. I try not to like throw myself any curveballs because like I already have enough shit going on. I mean, there's like always opportunity, you know, chance that I could fuck up, but that's like not one of the things that I want to accidentally fuck up. But sometimes I'll be like, oh man, the crowd's not, I don't know. No, I mean, yeah, I guess it depends. Some nights I might like skip a certain song because I'm like, oh, these people don't, I don't think they feel this type of way about this thing tonight or whatever. But generally I try to keep it, you know. Question? Yes.
I was wondering, because I think you had like 6 computers on that Kanye photo.
Mm-hmm. Like how many? 5?
Thought about using like an iMac or a Mac Pro or something for some of those live shows for better, more processing power?
No.
You have less screens than
you can't look at as much. You can't edit a Mac Pro on your knee in the dressing room right before the show's getting started.
Plus, the Mac Pro is faster than the Mac Pro right now. The 2016 MacBook Pro is the fastest Mac you can buy right now. It's faster than the Mac Pro. So you might as well get the portable.
Are the computers synced, by the way? Yeah. Are the computers synced in any way?
Oh, yeah. Totally. Yep.
How many computers do you, like, use?
They're all, how many?
Like
4 in a screen share. Yeah.
And is that...
Oh, for me or for other people?
For you.
Oh, for me.
Yeah.
Oh, I just live dangerously and use one. But like when I get my front of house person and like my lighting designer and all that kind of stuff, then I'll have 2 probably. But yeah, I like to live dangerously, and I also have like violin, so I could just play that.
So the Ableton are actually synced on each computer?
I just have 1 computer, yeah. But it never, nothing ever happens, because it's like, because Ableton's amazing, man. Did you guys know that I started the first user group in 2007 in LA? Isn't that crazy? It's like full circle. Any other questions? Okay, so I wanted to say some last parting words. First of all, okay. This is happening tomorrow, 7 o'clock,
in the dot.
This is just a show. I mean, yeah, but my EP came out in November, so. But if you want to see this further, then you guys can follow me on Instagram and all that stuff. And if you enjoyed what you heard, saw tonight, I'd appreciate a shout out. So I can get more people involved with my mission. And I also have this mailing list thing on this iPad, and it's kind of the first time that I've used it. So I would love it if you guys would sign up for my mailing list if you're feeling it. And I'll send you like free music and all that good stuff. So. Thank you guys so much.